All right, I'm ready to start the next project. We took one of these knives on the last project. We got this blade from Atlanta Cutlery, went there, bought it. It was $39. And we put our own handle on it. This is a little bit different than the traditional style handle. This knife now looks pretty similar to what was used in the Resident Evil movies. I think it's part 3, where our main character in Resident Evil has a two knives similar to this. But anyway, after completing it, we decided we didn't want to use it for its intended purpose, which is to hack and slash and brush and stuff when we're camping. So me and my boy decided we're going to make another knife. Well, I'm going to make a knife and he's going to go play airsoft and whatever else he wants to do. But anyway, this piece of angle iron came from a what a guy told me was some piece of metal left over at a construction site. It was a piece of scaffolding. And it's hard to tell the hardness of it. I mean, it seems definitely like it might be, it's harder than that. I've used this piece of steel for a number of different projects. I've cut chunks out of it, and it's tough stuff, whatever it is. I don't know what type of steel it is. I'm working with an unknown metal type. It is harder than your traditional hot rolled steel, but not real hard. I mean, it's not your typical knife steel either. It'll be good enough for what we want to do. It'll be perfectly good for hacking at, you know, 1-inch diameter limbs and whatnot. And it's going to look cool. It's the main thing. We want it to look cool. So this is what we got with what the scrap section I had. I wanted a slightly curved blade like our Kukri. I wanted it to take and have a long enough handle, and with what I had to weld another little piece of metal in here, and I'm going to grind that smooth for our handle. I'm also going to add on the end of our handle here another piece of metal, a little round piece of metal here that's basically going to be the pommel. That way it doesn't slip from our hands. Since this is going to be a work tool and there's going to be some slashing and hacking with it, I don't want it to slip out of his hands or anyone else's and stick me in the back of the head or anything while we're out camping. So I want a handle on here to keep it from slipping out of anyone's hand. That's going to be shaped, you know, with a little round shape or maybe a wedge shaped piece on the end. All right, I milled the top part off here. I stayed just above the line I made. I cut the end off so that we can slide on our guard. I'm going to go ahead and see if I can find a piece of metal to make the guard from. I think I have a piece of stainless steel around here. Well, you know what? I think I did cut a piece of brass, didn't I? All right, I got some Prussian blue on our little piece of brass here we're going to use for the guard. I've marked the center of it. I'm just going to scribe a line. That's going to be approximately down the center of it. Alright, now I have to decide how I want to position this on here. And I think about like this will work. The majority of the guard up towards the top. Put the bottom of it right here. So now I just take my knife handle. Set it on here like so. Scribe a line down there. I'm going to do the same thing I did on the other one. I'll take a small drill bit and drill through this thing on the inside of it. Or you know what? It might be easier, perhaps this time, to use a 1/8 inch end mill, and I'll just mill that out. Be a little bit easier than drilling 50 holes in there. If you guys saw the video where I made the knife, out of the blade we got from Atlanta Cutlery. We scribed the inside shape on our piece of brass, and then I drilled it out with a small drill bit. That took quite a bit of time. And with the sides of this being parallel, just a simple rectangle, it'll be a lot easier to mill it and then file the corners to shape. That was fast and easy. It pays to have the right tools. We'll go ahead and get this out of here, get it on the workbench, and then we'll clean it up and file it to fit our knife handle. All right, we just about got it. It was almost a perfect fit, but it's not going all the way as up towards the blade. So I'm going to do some more filing here. Then it should just slip right on. All right, we got the guard filed so that it slides on easy. It's a little loose up top, it's a little tighter back here, but that's fine. When we put our handles on, we'll pack it full of 5-minute epoxy here, and that'll keep it tight and secure. That and the fact that the wood will be tied up against it as well. All right, the way the guard came out here, it doesn't quite line up even with the top of the blade. So what I'm going to do is at the top of the blade right here, I'm going to just mill it down a little bit to where it's even with the top of our guard. It won't take a lot of strength away from our knife handle. In fact, it'll make it look a little more even and uniform. And our blade will still have plenty of strength due to the fact that it is almost 1/4 inch thick. It'll be a lot stronger anyway than those blades you see at those machetes that they're available at other places anyway that you can buy. There aren't too many this thick. Alright, I'm going to mill that off, and then after I do that, before I even begin any more work on the rest of this handle, we're going to take the blade and contour the cutting edge of the blade. Let me back the camera out. What we're going to do, what I intend to do, is measure up, I don't know, maybe 5/8 of an inch, and put the what will be the cutting edge on this blade with the 4.5 inch grinder. I want it to have the same chisel point as an axe blade, not necessarily a knife edge, because if it is softer than regular high carbon knife steel, and I don't want it to dull or the blade to dent too easily. But the same chisel point that an axe blade has will be perfect for our use for this. We'll start out with 1/2 inch. And that'll give us a decent chisel point. If it turns out that it's too much of a chisel point, we'll go back 3/4 inch. But I think 1/2 inch will be good. So mark this, I'll just measure up 1/2 inch in several places. Mark the blade. Basically then play connect the dots. I'll do this on both sides of the blade. Alright, I'm trying to be careful to only go through 1/2 the thickness out here on the edge, so I'm trying to taper it back a little bit. I'm not going to go beyond the line. In fact, I'm not even going to go all the way up to that line that we made. And as I see, we're creating an edge here, and as soon as we approach halfway through the thickness of our knife here, we're going to take and stop on this side. I'm going to try to keep it uniform like I said, I want to have a chisel, the same type of chisel point an axe has, not so much of a knife edge that a regular hunting knife would have. I want a chisel point on it, that way it will dull out far less quickly. I got the edge sharpened up and ground to where I want it. It's about a taper, the same taper you'd find on an axe blade. So that's good enough. I don't want it any sharper or any duller than it is. What I'm going to do now is reshape our guard. We've got our guard how we want to fit it, as far as how much it extends on towards the bottom and towards the top. I'm happy with that. What I'm going to work on now is the width. I want to take and cut the width down a little bit. In order to do that, what I'm going to do is use this old sanding disc here is a 3-inch diameter sanding disc, so I'll put it on our guard right here. Like that, somewhat even. And let's see what kind of shape we've got. Okay, let's go a little bit wider with that. Okay, I like it closer towards the top than we do on the bottom. What I'll do is I'll measure it from our slot to the top right there, and I'll put it the same uniform distance on this side. Then we'll grind it down. Actually, I'll put it in a mill and mill that extra material off, and our guard will be finished. All right, guys, I got the guard cleaned up pretty good. It's not polished perfectly, not as nice as the guard I made for our display knife, but anyway, it's good enough. It's good enough for this brush chopper. This is a knife I think even Bear Grylls would be proud of. You could use it for just about anything. All right, next thing we're going to do is weld our pommel on. Well, I say pommel, but it's basically the back of the knife. I want it a little bit wider back here where the knife handle won't slip out of our hands very easily. It'll flare out a little bit on the end. We're going to weld that on and then start fitting the handles. I'll cut the handle to length that we're going to use, and then I'll put it in my saw and split it in half. That way we can rivet it onto our guard here. Now that we've got our weld ground off, it's time to get ready to make our handle, our actual handle for it. I've marked the old axe handle here where we're going to cut it. After we cut it in our saw, we'll split it in half. After we get it split in half, we'll be able to pair it up to each side of our handle, and that'll help us determine, based on how much material we have and how it fits, it'll help me determine what shape we want to have down here. Do we want to simply have a round shape, which is fairly easy to do, or do we want it to be kind of a trapezoid shape on the bottom? But based on how it turns out, how much material we have to work with, and how it fits here on the handle, that'll help us decide how we want to shape the bottom. And to me, this shape down here is important. We want it to kind of flare out so that when we're using it, you know, it doesn't tend to slip out of the hand very easily. All right, I've got my chunk of wood I'm going to use for the handle set up in my miniature machinist vise. And I've got the vise itself in the horizontal saw, so that's the easiest way to do this, I think. And it looks like it's centered. I mean, it doesn't look perfectly once you line it up. It's dead centered at the top, where the top of the handle is going to be, but it doesn't quite look it down here towards the bottom, but I think that's all right. We'll be sanding off some of that material. All right. Okay, guys, we've got the handle split in half. It didn't turn out exactly as good as I wanted. It didn't turn out perfect. We started to get off center a little bit on one side over here, and I was able to catch it in time, so it only made a little bit of a split. We're going to fix that by filling this split with 5-minute epoxy. It won't be a big deal. Probably won't even notice when we're finished. But by doing it like this, splitting it in half, it allows us to see exactly how we want to position these slabs. Okay, guys, based on what wood we have to work with and what material we have, I've decided what I'm going to wind up having to do is probably cut most of this metal off right here. And in fact, what I'm going to do is tack weld it on over here. And that'll allow us to have more of a ledge in the back, something to catch our finger on to keep this thing from slipping out of our hands. For quite a while now, I've been shaping this handle. This is what it looks like so far. This is what the knife handle itself looks like. So these slabs have been shaped. I just got to sand them smooth. It's a comfortable shape, fits my grip comfortably, and we'll go ahead and sand them smooth now, and then I'll get ready to attach them to our blade. Okay, guys, we're ready for the next step, which is to attach our slabs. We're getting ready to do that anyway. I'm going to mark on our handle here where I want the rivets to be placed. That'll work. See how accurately I laid them out. Now we're going to take and drill these slabs to the handle after we drill the handle. I want to point out that before I got ready to attach these, or got to this point, I did take and sand these smooth. I don't believe I videoed that, so I wanted you to see that. But we're going to go ahead and drill these right now. That way we can drill the handles, and then we'll flip it over and we'll drill this handle. Alright, we've got it clamped in place. Now as I get through to breaking through the other side of the wood, I'm just going to go really slow and turn the drill bit really fast. You don't want to push, otherwise it'll splinter the wood out. Alright, I put one of our pins through the top slab and then all the way through our metal here. They help keep this slab aligned, and now I'm going to drill all the way through. The reason I did that is I want to be able to keep this handle perfectly matched up with this one, that way I can keep them paired up. I don't know, it's possible you don't need to do that, but that's how I did it. All right. Now we're going to take the rivets that I've made for this. I'm just using pieces of copper ground wire that I've had laying around. And I'm going to cut them to length. I've already roughed them out, but we'll get them cut to length. and get ready to rivet them on. Before we rivet them on, though, we're going to go ahead and coat everything with 5-minute epoxy, just like we did on our display knife. And then we'll do our final sanding after everything's riveted together. Okay, we've got our holes here countersunk. Now we're ready to mix up our 5-minute epoxy, put our rivets in place, and secure the handle, our slabs, to our handle. And that portion of it will be done. After we do that, we'll let the epoxy cure, probably overnight, so it sands easier. And tomorrow we'll sand it. What I'm going to do with this off-center slice right here, I'm going to pack that full of 5-minute epoxy when we're assembling it, and then I'll pack it full of sawdust. So hopefully it won't even be noticeable. Is all of this necessary? I don't know. I think the rivets would be just fine. But if you've seen any of my other videos, you know I overkill everything, and I don't want to ever have a problem with these handles loosening up. Although I guess it could be cured just by tapping on the rivets a little bit. Alright. Get this slab in place. Clamp ready. Work the hammer around the rivet. This is just a piece of thick piece of copper, but you want to kind of dome it. Alright, we don't have to worry about that rivet coming loose. That one there is tight. We filled in that countersink really well, I think, on both sides. You know what? Now that we have the opportunity, before this glue gets too hard, and it's already getting pretty stiff, let me get that off of there and pack some sawdust. Pack some sawdust into this crack. All right, that's a good one. Now the glue's already starting to set up. Hopefully that we'll get this one down before it gets too hard. Okay, I'm happy with that rivet. All the rivets are riveted at this point. I got all three tight. Now I'm going to take a razor and skim off this 5-minute epoxy before it sits hard and gets too hard. It's easier to get it off now. Right now it kind of rolls off. Tomorrow we'll have to grind it off. Alright, once you get all your 5-minute epoxy off, you let it sit about 24 hours. Let this epoxy cure. and then you'll be able to sand it. After that, we'll finish sand it. We'll get our rivets ground down, but we're almost done. This is certainly going to be something that I'm going to be pretty proud of. I really like the way it's come out so far. I don't think I explained this. I might have. It's been a couple days since we riveted our handles on. But when you're riveting your copper rivet like we were doing, you know, I made the countersink and the wooden handle so that we could take and allow the copper to fill that countersink and keep our slabs on. You don't want to just hammer straight down on your copper rivet. What I was doing, if you could see in the video, is working the face of the hammer around the edge of our piece of copper. And what that does is it flares it out. It's going to flare it out, smear the copper out, and spread it out into the countersink. If you were hammering it straight down, you're going to do what I did on my first knife project when I was about 14. I used the same pieces of copper, just like this, I used that my dad had in his garage, hammered it straight down, it compressed the rivet, and it split the wooden handle. So that's probably where I first learned a little bit about riveting. Hammering it straight down will compress it, split the handle. You want to work the hammer around the edge of the little copper rod you're using and form the rivet that way. And of course I did both sides, and I have a nice rivet tail formed on each side. And when we countersunk it, the rivet is now inside that countersink so that when we sand it smooth, it's not going to pop off. And of course the 5-minute epoxy is also going to help keep everything in place. But what I'm going to do now is sand these smooth, get that copper sanded down flush with the surface of the wood, try not to screw the wood up in the process, and then we'll sand everything by hand and get this all smoothed out. I'm not going to take the rivet completely flush. I just want to take any sharp edges off of it. I'm going to polyurethane over top of these rivets after we decide what kind of stain we're going to use for the handle, so I really won't be able to feel any edges around it. Put a gray burnishing pad on my 90 grinder, so I'm going to polish these rivets up a little bit. Take the sanding marks out of them. Now that we've got our rivets smoothed out, we're going to have to go back and polish them again when we're done sanding, but I just wanted to hit them a little bit. We'll scratch them up some more while we're sanding the rest of this handle. I've got some sandpaper here. I don't even know what grit it is. It's about a medium grit, I think. But we're going to sand our handle with it. Get some of this glue removed. I'm probably going to have to take it off the sanding block because the sanding block is just not going to work for our needs. See, the 5-minute epoxy, the areas that the 5-minute epoxy is on is sanding real nice. That's why you got to wait for it to fully cure before you try to sand it. If you don't, it's going to gum up your sandpaper. Alright, I'm happy with how the handles turned out now. I tried to get in on the back side of the guard and remove some of our epoxy with that burnishing disc. You can see there's still some thin traces of epoxy there. I'm not too concerned about it. This thing is just going to be a tool, and it's going to wind up getting abused if it's used properly. What I plan to do next is on the rest of the blade, I'm going to get some masking tape, tape off the edge here that we have that's nice and shiny. And then I'm gonna paint the rest of the blade flat black. I think that'll look pretty cool. It'll have a nice, it'll offset everything real nice. We'll have a light colored wood handle here. We'll have a shiny edge, and the blade will be, the rest of the blade will be flat black. I've had so much linseed oil on it, let it soak in for so long, that I really don't know how much the tongue oil is gonna soak in, so I'm just gonna use some polyurethane, get it over and done. It's been soaking actually in the front seat of my truck. It's been sitting out in the sun, so it's got a little bit of heat on it. We'll go ahead and apply the polyurethane, and it'll cure a lot faster, dry a lot faster. All right, our second coat of polyurethane's dried. I'm gonna put one more on it. This will be our last coat of polyurethane. That'll give us a total of three coats, and we'll let it dry. And tomorrow we'll be painting the blade black. The polyurethane is dry on our handle. Now that that's done, we're gonna worry about the rest of the blade. We're going to clean it all off with acetone, and I wanna prime it today. We'll spray it with some flat black primer, and then we'll spray it with a semi-gloss just to help seal the primer. Dry to the touch. We're going to take it outside, let it sit in the sun for the rest of the day. This is how we look so far. It's a nice looking machete. I really like it. I really like the way it came out. Right,
for the first test of our machete, we're going to cut down this, I don't know what this thing is, this weird looking brush plant. They grow everywhere on our property, and it's really hard to kill them. Go ahead and chop it, see if we can't get rid of that thing. You may have to come from the other side and swing so that that tree's not in your way. And remember what I told you about being safe. Well, that was nice. Get closer down towards the bottom. Good, good. All right, well, that made short work of that. Let's find something else.
There's another one. It's about a half inch in diameter at the bottom. Start at the bottom and chop that sucker down. You may have to come from this side because you got a tree in your way there. Good, good. Get those little ones. Nice. All right, let's see if we can find something a little bit bigger to whack. All right, we got a tree here that's in the way of my gate. I can't get past it without the limbs hitting me in the face. It's an inch in diameter on the bottom. Go ahead and take it out. Already?
Yep. Wait.
Yeah. That's nice. Just four or five whacks and it's down. Another one there, half an inch in diameter. Oh, come on now. There you go. That's the machete. That works really well. It came out perfect. Do you like it, or did it come out all right? Are you happy with it?
I am.
Where are you gonna keep it? You gonna leave it laying out in the yard, or are you gonna take care of it?
Yeah.
Good, good. I'm glad you like it. It's a lot better than those machetes they had at the gun show for $35, ain't it? Mm-hmm. I hope you guys liked watching this video where we made the machete. It's way better than the piece of crap stuff we saw at the gun show. I think this is something Bear Grylls would even be happy to carry around if he was stuck out in the wilderness somewhere, but I don't know if he'd like the weight of it. It is kind of heavy. It's got some heft to it. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to subscribe and click like. We'll see you guys next time.